Well, our story begins, you know, with old St. Augustine. Way back in days of old, he reported on this theme. A mighty emperor had caught himself a pirate who was terrorizing people who were sailing on the open seas.
What meanest thou by keeping hostile possession of the sea?
What meanest thou by seizing the whole earth? Because I do it with a petty ship, I'm called a robber. Whilst thou, who does the same with a great fleet, art styled emperor.
And old St. Augustine thought that was a pretty smart answer. Cause there are pirates and emperors, but they're really the same thing. When they go and try to reach the same ends by using the same means, whether do it big or they do it small, from a little tiny boat or from hallowed walls, bully is as bully does, that's plain to see. Speaking of bullies, what would you say about a gang of vicious low-down thugs who were trying to overthrow the government by attacking undefended civilian targets like schools, farms, hospitals, and outreach centers?
Why, I'd say they were terrorists.
I'm sorry, the correct answer is freedom fighters. At least that's what you called these thugs, aka the Contras, when you funded their campaign of terror and indiscriminate killing to overthrow the government of Nicaragua. There was trouble in the land of Nicaragua in the 80s, it's true. And Uncle Sam has always said this kind of thing just really won't do. So he paid for a bag full of dirty tricks and turned killers into heroes with a PR blitz. Well, freedom's sure a funny word for what the Contras did do. You know, there are pirates and emperors, but they're really the same thing. Even the ones who say they just wanna let freedom ring. Well, they do it big or they do it small, but only one goes down when they break the law. While the big one claims,
this really don't apply to me.
The funny thing about pirates and emperors is that they often start out as pals who get into a tiff somehow and end up enemies.
You mean like Lex Luthor and Superman?
Yeah, except Lex Luthor was a nice guy before he lost all his hair. Whereas Manuel Noriega, Saddam Hussein, and Osama bin Laden were all known thugs and mass murderers when they were on the CIA payroll. That's why they got the job. Either that, or Uncle Sam is just a really bad judge of character.
I don't understand why this keeps happening to me.
Well, not so long ago, we thought Saddam here was a pretty swell guy. And we helped him get the goods to make the Ayatollah Khomeini cry. But Uncle Sam decided it was not Saddam's fate to be the leader of his Middle Eastern client state that was sitting on top of a big, huge oil supply. Big and little thugs got thuggery incoming, even if one's got stars and stripes on him. Bully is as bully does, that's plain to see. Cause if it looks like a duck and acts like a duck and quacks like a duck, it probably is a duck. You know, a rose is a rose no matter how much it stinks.
I resent that comment. I'm not a duck. I'm an anti-duck. I'm a counter-duck. Well, I'm more of a mallard, really. Why, I'm fighting a war on ducks. Any ducks come around here, I'm gonna blast them.
Hi, welcome to Peace Propaganda, a weekly show about living peacefully and the people who try to prevent it.
This is Adam.
This is Becky.
Today we're going to talk about sort of the practical applications of anarchism and libertarianism. We had a request from somebody on Twitter and a few of our other fans, but specifically a user named
Ivor Thomas. He's requested a discussion about the environmental issues that we face today and how they can be handled without the state, as well as I think, which entails some questions about how it's handled currently by the state, and kind of brings up the question of the tragedy of the commons, which is a frequent, you know, rebuttal to anarchist free market beliefs.
Yeah, I think. Well, why don't we start with that? Because I think the I feel like the tragedy of the commons is a really fundamentally misunderstood metaphor, that people would then go to government as a solution to the tragedy of the commons, I think is reflects a fundamental misunderstanding of what the tragedy of the commons is meant to represent.
Indeed.
So the tragedy of the commons, for those of you who don't know, is the idea that, it's based on this scenario where many farmers are sharing land in common, and there's grass on the land. All of the farmers have, say, cows. And since it's commonly owned land, all of the farmers just basically rush their cows onto the grass.
Right. They have every incentive to just use up the resource
exactly
as quickly there's, as possible.
Basically. There's no, yeah, right. There's no, because they know that if they don't put their cows on the grass,
somebody else
on
will.
Monday, it'll all be gone by Tuesday.
Yeah.
Because somebody else will do it. And so the misunderstanding occurs when people then say, okay, so what we need to do here is have a central organization delineate who can put their cows on there when. Which really runs into a problem of knowledge, and this is what Mises refers to as the socialist calculation problem, where you don't know in a central command economy, you don't know the value of property and of goods, and so how this would apply to the example is the central control here in the tragedy of the commons would misallocate who got to use the grass when.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I think whenever you sort of allocate ownership to a public authority like the government, what you're really doing is you're failing to allocate ownership.
Right. Yeah.
And so you really destroy the incentives
exactly
of that property rights properly protected provide.
Right. And so there's sort of two ways to attack this this idea of the tragedy of the commons being solved by central authority. The first way is that it's, as I said, there's the calculation issue. So even assuming that the central command has every incentive and really wants to do right by these farmers, they literally can't do the math properly because there is no price mechanism
right
for the land. They just can't know. It's not possible for any one central authority figure to make these calculations. And that's sort of the top down. That's like the top overview of this concept. If you want to know more about it, Ludwig von Mises wrote Socialist Calculation or the Economic Calculation in the Socialist Commonwealth. It's free to download. It's the IP has run on it long ago. I highly recommend going to read that. And so that's the argument from an economics point of view. And then, as I'm sure Becky would be more than happy to elaborate, there is a problem from what is commonly called regulatory capture, right?
Right. I mean, there's a... Right. The problem that exists here is that you need property rights to be protected adequately in order for a private, you know, for a private property free market solution to work. But when all of your courts are captured by big, you know, big corporations who are capturing them through regulation, you really don't have a functioning property rights system.
Right. And ironically, it's actually usually the environmentalists who will point to this. They'll say, for example, in Alaska, there's a lot of, quote, publicly owned land, i.e. government-owned land, that many environmentalists point to as basically it has its own intrinsic value. It should be preserved because it's beautiful natural habitat for some of the most fragile wildlife in the world. And I am deeply sympathetic to that view, as a matter of fact.
Right. I mean, the disagreement again, which and this is usually the source of disagreement between an anarchist and anybody else, is, you know, yes, we agree that these rights should be preserved, or this natural, you know, habitat should be preserved, or whatever it is. We believe that we should be, you know, preserving
things. Exactly, yeah.
But we don't think that the way to go about that is with guns.
Right, yeah. And so one only needs to look at the practical effects of these efforts. You know, everybody points to, you know, the U.S. national park system, which I would concede is largely has largely achieved its goal in that there are areas where people can go and enjoy nature, but as again in Alaska, you know, they're drilling and there's been some terrible accidents that have happened in Alaska. Any environmentalist worth their salt will tell you all about the Keystone Pipeline, which has every indication of being an environmental disaster. Not to mention fracking, not to mention this the thing in West Virginia where the water just got contaminated. I'm not sure if you've heard about that. All of these things have happened on publicly owned land.
Right.
This is the tragedy of the commons. This is what happens when the government owns the land. And so it's an argument both from the economics and from a consequentialist view. Okay, and so we got the music coming up, but after that, me and Becky are going to tell you about the anarchist solution. People know this world is a wreck. I'm sick and tired of being politically correct. I see through it now, but I didn't at first. The hypocrites made it worse and worse. Looking down the nose is what people say. These are just words and words, okay. What you do and not what you say. If you're not part of the future, then get out of the way. Come on, baby, take a ride with me. I'm in the air, not a Tennessee. Everything is cool as can be in a peaceful world. I want to take this opportunity to tell you about Sean's Outpost, a homeless outreach program which has provided over 20,000 meals to the homeless in Northwest Florida. They're also funded entirely through Bitcoin donations. They are proving that we can address the problems in our community without the state, without its predatory welfare programs, and without its Ponzi money. Recently, Sean's Outpost launched its newest, boldest initiative, Satoshi Forest, a 9-acre homeless sanctuary where they are teaching permaculture, aquaponics, and self-sufficiency to the homeless residents. No one sticks a gun in anyone's face and makes them donate to Sean's Outpost, and yet, every day, people do. Please consider donating to this inspiring cause. Visit seansoutpost.com. That's S-E-A-N-S outpost.com. When I think back on all the crap I learned in high school, it's a wonder I can think at all. And my lack of education hasn't hurt me none. I can read the writing.
So, we were just talking about how the tragedy of the commons is a problem that is something that needs to be handled, obviously, because the environment is something that needs to be sustained. But when we don't have property rights enforced by
anyone,
pretty much, yeah, you really start to run into incentive issues, among other issues. But I really want to focus on what happens when you start to privatize these common resources, because what seems to happen pretty much every time is that once somebody owns something like a plot of land or a natural spring water, river, stream, whatever.
Yeah.
At that point, they have every incentive to make sure that piece of property is maintained.
Right.
Because if they don't, then they lose their investment.
Right. That's exactly right. And as a matter of fact, there's a perfect example of this. I'll find it for the show notes exactly where it is, but it's somewhere in one of the Nordic countries. Basically, they had a real problem with overfishing, and it's because all of the fishing rights were being handed out by the government. It was a perfect example of the tragedy of the commons, where they attempted to solve it through central command, and it failed miserably. The fish population was just devastated, because everybody, you know, they were just handing out the permits. They just didn't care, because they were getting money for each permit that they handed out. So they were just giving out,
yeah.
You know, they were just rubber stamping it. And so finally it just got so bad that they were just desperate to try something else. And they're like, let's try something crazy like privatizing it. And so they literally privatized, you know, like vast swaths of their coast. out to fishing companies. And so now what they had was a practical example of anarchism, of property rights solving the issue. And so, you know, part of the coast A belonged to company A, or, you know, person A, or whoever happened to buy it, right? And so they knew if they didn't go out on Monday to catch all the fish, they'd still be there on Tuesday.
Right.
And, I mean, what more do you need? All that, you don't need this whole elaborate system of a central command trying to calculate who should catch how much fish and, right, you know, what, you just, who should get a license for what in this, in what season, and blah, blah, blah. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, you just have to be able to trust that everybody else wants what's in their own best interest.
Right. I mean, the people who were willing to buy this plot of ocean were not the people who wanted to overfish it.
Yeah, yeah,
right.
Exactly.
They had every incentive to keep the land, or in this case, the sea, productive.
Exactly.
And this is the proper application of the tragedy of the commons. You don't fix a tragedy of the commons situation by solidifying it into the commons through it being public property. That's the exact opposite of what you want to do. You want to decentralize it. And I want to footnote what you said, because I think you're absolutely right when you said privatize. I think that is the right word. But I want to be crystal clear here, because there are so many people who bristle at the idea of privatization. So we're not talking about the government, you know, taking tax money, building something, and then turning it over to their corporate cronies. Are we clear on that? Are we crystal clear on that? That's not what we're talking about.
This is pretty important to understand, yeah.
It's so not what we're talking about. We're talking about just the classical liberal term of private property, privatization.
Right. So that's an interesting example, the fishing example. Another really interesting example of tragedy of the commons seeming to be fixed by private ownership is Bitcoin. Hmm. I think it's maybe a little bit more controversial whether this is actually what's happening with Bitcoin and the idea of the 51% attack. But basically the idea is that there are situations in the Bitcoin environment where the miners who have, you know, control over, to some degree, some amount of control over what gets decided on, what gets agreed upon as what has happened, they, you know, it has been raised as a question whether they would act honestly because you know, they could.
I want to elaborate here. Bitcoin, of course, is an online decentralized currency, which is not issued by any government. It's privately owned. It's not issued by any corporation either. And so what Becky's referring to when she refers to the miners are the people who do transactions and confirm transactions on the Bitcoin public ledger.
In a totally decentralized way.
Exactly. It's not done or controlled by any corporation. However, what you're referring to are these mining pools, which are basically collective of people,
right,
who have pooled their processing power in order to more efficiently distribute the earnings from the transaction fees, which are generated by doing the processes on the Bitcoin network.
Right. And so you end up with these two sort of battling sets of incentives. And one is for, you know, all of these people with some small amount of computing power to contribute to this larger mining scheme. But if they get too powerful, then the integrity of the whole system is in question.
What you're referring to is there's a technical aspect to Bitcoin wherein if any one entity gets a majority share in the Bitcoin network, it is mathematically possible for them to effectively print fraudulent bitcoins is the simple way to put it.
Right.
And so what you're talking about there is a competing interest between every individual has an interest in being part of a large mining pool because it's more profitable. But if it gets too big, then it's not profitable for anyone.
But what's important is that this has happened a few times in Bitcoin's history, and it seems like every time it gets corrected because the people who hold ownership in Bitcoin really would like to preserve the integrity of the system, and so they avoid causing that problem.
Yeah. Oh, that's a great example. Okay, well, we'll be right back with more of that right after the break.
my weary heart, it was the prettiest thing I'd ever seen. I knew I had to keep my love alive.
Hey, this is Becky, host of Peace Propaganda. I know that starting something new is really hard, but it's important to get our message heard. That's why we want to help you promote your liberty-related project. We're offering free 45-second time spots on Peace Propaganda. That's right, free. So, do you have something that you're trying to promote? Contact us at host.peacepropaganda@gmail.com. That's host.peacepropaganda@gmail.com. You can send us information about your project and we'll share it on the show. We look forward to hearing from you. So, the funny thing about the tragedy of the commons is that it is so often represented as a tragedy, but in reality, I think that the argument is more accurately a comedy of the commons, because the government itself is the largest example of the tragedy of the commons.
Yeah.
And yeah. So it basically makes the entire argument moot, in my opinion.
I agree. I think you're right on with that. But I want to elaborate and clarify that when we're pointing the finger at the government, that is, we're pointing the finger at the root. And so many people, particularly on the left, are very sensitive to this analysis, because they say, well, Adam, Becky, you're leaving out the corporations. And that's fair. It's a fair criticism, because it's true. We're not. But from our analysis, the corporations are part and parcel with the government and would not exist without the government. So for example, you know, these large polluters, how do they poison our water systems? It's because the government, first of all, is giving them corporate liability shields. So if they poison my water and I get sick and die, my family has basically no recourse, because the government has already said, no, it's okay. We gave them a license.
Right. I mean, they're clearly not preventing it.
Right. Oh, they're absolutely not preventing it. And, and then, so that's just one of many ways that the government allows these corporations to exist. Not to mention, you know, direct subsidies in the form of oil, you know, which, without getting too into the specifics, allow these corporations to grow to an unmanageable size, you know, multinational corporations. And then, of course, as we were just talking about, literally giving them basically monopoly power over parts of. Of areas.
Right. To me, that's sort of the parallel argument, the idea that the government is both the largest example of the tragedy of the commons, as well as the largest example of monopoly. Mm-hmm. And I think that what's actually happening is that it's, you know, they're the largest examples of those two things, but they're also the source of all of the other examples of those things.
Exactly. So when... Yeah, that's exactly right. So that's why we so often point at the government. It's not because we're blind to the rapacious corporations. We're fully aware of that. I mean, we've talked numerous times about how we've both come from the left here. And that's, I mean, journey from the left pretty much starts at pointing your finger at Monsanto and Walmart.
Right.
I mean, mm-hmm. Correct me if I'm wrong, but you know, we are not blind to that at all. But the reason we point to the government is because we see that as the root cause. And there's no point in hacking at the branches when you can look at the root.
Yeah, I guess my feeling about corporations, which I think is important to sort of note, is that they aren't good or evil. They're pretty much just neutral. And the rules of the game are what makes the game good or evil. And the problem that we're having right now is that the rules of the game are pretty much non-existent, because, you know, you know, people like John Corzine can walk away with billions of dollars of customer funds and you know, can basically not be punished for breaking the rules. So there aren't any rules.
Exactly. And that's a perfect way to end the show, because we're coming up on the end here. But that was the beginning that we were listening to, the Emperors and Pirates song, which is just brilliant, by the way. Well, there is a link to that in the show notes, which, of course, highly recommend that you go to the show notes. Not a lot of clips today, but you can at least find that. And we're going to put up the article that we mentioned earlier. But that opening song was about, there's no difference between pirates and emperors. It's just a matter of degree. It's who has control.
Right.
And that's exactly what you're talking about. There's no difference in what the corporations want to do and what the government wants to do. It's just a matter of, like, literally who owns the guns.
Yeah, and none of it is good or bad, like, because it's all just actions. The results are what we need to look at, the results of the actions.
Yeah.
And when the results of the actions are negative, we need to look at the rules that are in place and how they're being enforced.
Yeah, that would be sort of the consequentialist argument, and I would be remiss not to mention the moral argument, which is the non-aggression principle. It's just flat out illegitimate to use violence against people who are peaceful.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what these corporations are allowed to do when they pollute our waterways and we have no chance for restitution. They're using violence against us.
Right. And there would be no way that a company like Walmart would be allowed to do that under the view of customers who get to decide whether they spend their money there.
Yes,
right?
Exactly. And that's what it's really about. It's about giving people choice and taking away these monopoly powers that the corporations have. Well, hey, thanks for joining us again for another episode of Peace Propaganda. Again, please go to the show notes where you'll find links to all the songs, the wonderful songs that we picked out for you today. Obviously, you can follow us on Twitter, on Facebook, on iTunes and Stitcher, and of course SoundCloud. We're going to be launching a YouTube channel. There's not going to be videos, but it'll just be one more way that people can listen to us easily. So if that's something that you're interested in, we'll have more information about that in the show notes, and we'll talk about it next week. And of course, the Bitcoin tip jar you will find there. So that's it for Saturday, February 15th.
Have a great week.
For billions of years since the outset of time, every single one of your ancestors survived. Every single person on your mum and dad's side successfully looked after and passed on to you life. What are the chances of that like? It comes to me once in a while. And everywhere I tell folk, it gets the best smile. And then the old man walked away and out of sight, till the sound of him hiking turned to the sound of silence. I just froze in a profound surprise, and from down on my pride I found a smile to my eyes. And for many days again I'd be passing the same cliff, and on many occasions I'd chance on the same thing, laying in the moss in the same way I was, be another man looking like he needed a change of luck. So I'd say I lay right there once to the edge of the rock. I was ready to jump, I was ever so lost. But this gentleman stopped and said something I never forgot. For billions of years since the outset of time, every single one of your ancestors survived. Every single person on your mum and dad's side successfully looked after and passed on to you life. What are the chances of that like? It comes to me once in a while. And everywhere I tell folk, it gets the best smile. Billions of years since the outset of time, every single one of your ancestors survived. Every single person on your mum and dad's side successfully looked after and passed on to you life. What are the chances of that like? It comes to me once in a while. And everywhere I tell folk, it gets the best smile.